I mean, look, we cannot accommodate in Florida just dumping unlawful migrants into our state. I think it'll tax our resources, the schools, the health care, law enforcement, state agencies.
You think that this decision, the initial decision to send the migrants to these counties in Florida, was politically motivated?
Oh, absolutely. I will say it and I will repeat it over and over again. It's very well documented that we have people in the department that do not support the president. They do not support his agenda. They did not want to see him get elected. I mean, all we have to do is look at the FBI. The FBI didn't want to see him elected. Peter Stroke even said that they will make sure he doesn't get elected. That happens in the government. You have people that have agendas. They want to continue to move up, and because they don't have the same enforcement mind that this president has, they know that they have to undermine him, and that's what's taking place today.
Joining me now is the president of the National Border Patrol Council, Brandon Judd. Brandon, thank you for being here with me. There's obviously a lot going on at the border these days. We just learned on Wednesday that there were 1,000 migrants apprehended in El Paso. Obviously, they were illegally trying to cross the border. This is the largest group ever encountered at the Border Patrol. I guess the previous record was around 400 people. I mean, at what point are we going to get a handle on the border crisis? It seems to be getting worse.
Well, right now, we're not going to get a handle on the border crisis. Whether you're left, right, or in the middle, you have to look at these 1,000 people that we just arrested. I believe that was 2 days ago. It might have been yesterday. And you have to say that everything is completely and totally out of control. I can personally tell you that the Border Patrol has lost the enforcement ability to effectuate a border security program that is going to be good for the American public. We have completely and totally lost control of the border.
How do you even handle 1,000 people? How many Border Patrol agents were responding to that?
You don't, unless they're giving up. But the scary thing, and what the American public has to understand, is that these criminal cartels understand that when they cross 1,000 people into the United States, it takes all of our resources out of the field, and now they've artificially created gaps in the border, and now they can run across their drugs, their criminal aliens. They can run across all of those products that are very dangerous to the American public, and that's exactly what's going on here. 1,000 people they send across. We then pull all of our resources out of the field. Now they're free to do anything that they want on the border. And that's how we've lost complete and total control of the border.
I guess this number is surprising to me considering the summer heat. It's already 85, 90 degrees, maybe 95 degrees in some areas. So are we going to see the numbers, you know, reduce or decline during the summer months, or are we going to continue to see this? It's very dangerous for the people that are crossing. Imagine the heat, the sun, there's no shade, no water.
Yeah, no. In fact, we're going to continue to see numbers go up. We just saw, we've been seeing incremental numbers month by month, and then we saw a huge influx in the month of May, and now we're going to see numbers even greater in the month of June than May. We're actually looking in 1 month at potentially arresting around 150,000 people. That will be the most people that we have ever arrested in the history of the Border Patrol. And we have a long, long history. I mean, the Border Patrol has been around for 76 years, and we're on pace to arrest more people than we've ever arrested before.
Well, I think there were some 100,000 apprehended in either March or April or both months. I mean, the numbers are astounding. And I want to talk about the asylum seekers that are now being bused into the interior. We're hearing local news reports. We're hearing local officials discussing this. A lot of them are kind of caught off guard. They didn't know that these people were going to be going or bused to their towns or sent on planes. Who's making these calls, and how do you decide where the migrants will go?
So you've got a number of people that are involved in this, but it's ultimately the decision is being made at the Department of Homeland Security. They ultimately make the final decision. And when they decided that they were going to send people to Florida, every one of us were upset. All Border Patrol agents, CBP officers, everybody within the agency were extremely upset when we found out that they were going to be sent to Florida, because this is a state that has supported border security. So why would we flood that state with people that cross the border illegally? We should be sending these people. We have to release them. We have to release them somewhere. So if we have to release them, we should be releasing them in locations that claim that they actually want these people. San Francisco, why not send them there? Why not send them up to the state of Washington, the state of Oregon, these sanctuary states or sanctuary cities? Why not send them there? They claim to want these people, so send them to those areas. We never even should have contemplated sending people to a state like Florida.
Well, I'm glad that you brought up Florida, because I remember reading the reports that Governor Ron DeSantis was up in arms because he had received a couple phone calls from some of the counties who said that they had been notified by CBP that they were going to send plane loads of migrants to their communities. Yep. I think like 1,000 a month or something like that. And so, yeah, he was wondering, he's like, well, we're not a sanctuary state, and these aren't sanctuary cities that we were being told that they were going to send migrants to. And so who makes these decisions? And you're right, why wouldn't they send these to sanctuary cities like San Francisco or New York City or some of the other places? I mean, I can think of a good few places to send them. You know, Nancy Pelosi's front yard, Bill de Blasio's plaza over in New York City. I mean, there are some good places that these migrants could go where they should be welcome, because we're told over and over again that the people who don't want to welcome them are racist. So these people should be jumping, saying, you know, this is a net positive for us, so send them here.
You're absolutely correct. The decision was made, again, it's well documented that there are a lot of people in high-level positions in the Department of Homeland Security that do not support President Trump. They don't support his agenda. And so what they try to do is they try to embarrass him. They try to come out with, they try to make decisions that will ultimately undermine his position. And that's exactly what we saw with this Florida fiasco. Good for Ron DeSantis. Good for him taking, Governor DeSantis standing up, taking a stance for his state and for his people and saying, we're not going to take this. We're not going to accept these people. Send them elsewhere. And if the department truly cared about this president, if they cared about his agenda and trying to secure the border, they would do exactly what you just said. They would send them to these locations that claim that they care about these people, that they want these people. But what's funny is when that was mentioned, when President Trump said that I'm going to send these people to the sanctuary cities, you saw all these sanctuary cities step up and say, well, this is political retribution. You shouldn't do that. Why are you doing this? So they didn't put their money where their mouth was. They say that they claim that they care about these people, but when it came time to actually accepting them, they refused. That shows the hypocrisy.
Brandon, you said something that you don't hear a lot. You think that this decision, the initial decision to send the migrants to these counties in Florida, was politically motivated?
Oh, absolutely. I will say it and I will repeat it over and over again. It's very well documented that we have people in the department that do not support the president. They do not support his agenda. They did not want to see him get elected. I mean, all we have to do is look at the FBI. The FBI didn't want to see him elected. Peter Stroke even said that they will make sure he doesn't get elected. That happens in the government. You have people that have agendas. They want to continue to move up, and because they don't have the same enforcement mind that this president has, they know that they have to undermine him, and that's what's taking place today.
Well, you think more people would be asking questions like, who made the decision? Was there some sort of round table where people were sitting at and they were debating and deciding where they were going to send the migrants to? That's something that I'm curious about. I think that there should be transparency when it comes to these decisions that are being made, because cities, communities, states, they're going to be affected by all of these decisions. And like you said, it also undermines President Trump, and it is embarrassing for his administration.
One thing that I like about the federal government is they do have to document everything. Now, they can try to hide those documents for a certain amount of time, but entities like Judicial Watch, who does a great job of FOIAing this information, it will ultimately come out. And whoever that decision maker was, it will come out. The problem is it's going to come out too late to actually do something about it. But ultimately, it will come out, and the truth comes out, and the American public gets to see exactly how their government operates and acts. But because the laws do require the federal government to maintain records of everything that they do for so many years, this information ultimately will come out. But like I said, it's just going to be too late.
And I want to circle back to the 1,000 migrants that were detained in El Paso. So what happened to Mexico taking in the asylum seekers or migrants? Like, I thought that they were going to keep people in their detention facilities there.
So they talked a good game, and but when it came time for them to actually do something, they're just not doing what we need them to do. And let's be honest, it all comes down to money. Criminal cartels make billions of dollars a year on illicit traffic that comes across our borders. Well, that money is spent in Mexico, and so it boosts the Mexican economy. They don't want to lose the profits that come from illegal immigration, illegal drug smuggling. They don't want to lose all of these profits, and so you don't see the Mexican government doing enough to help the United States.
Brandon, what agencies are the most difficult to work with, or the offices, or where do you see a lot of pushback?
Well, when DHS was created after 9/11, we created this huge department that had so many different entities, and these entities have to work together if things are gonna function properly. But what you see is you see the commissioner of CBP and the director of ICE that can't work together because they have different goals trying to accomplish. But without them working together, we can't secure the border, and we can't our mission doesn't work properly. And so I am excited to see Mark Morgan get appointed as the director of ICE, and hopefully he'll be able to work with us better. But again, you have to understand, they have different goals than what CBP has. And if CBP isn't willing to help them reach their goals, then it makes it difficult for them to help CBP reach our goals. And so you see that what has to happen is we all have to be one entity, one agency. If we're one entity, one agency, then you don't have all of the personality conflicts. You don't have all of the different goals that you're trying to accomplish. But because we created this huge, unruly department, this is the outcome of that.